For the past few years, I've watched as friends tear themselves apart because of their over-obsession with the culture wars. And by culture wars, I mean almost everything that people yell at each other about on social media.
We want to take masks off our children. That should be our choice.
You are a white privileged male who has no experience.
I can't help what I am. I was born like this.
I'm not saying that people should not be allowed to go through that procedure. What I'm saying is it doesn't make them a woman. It happens to be an opinion.
These wars can consume our lives. I was curious to learn how things fell apart, and so I decided to go back in history and find the origin stories, the pebbles thrown in the pond, creating the ripples. I had no idea how surprising, how consequential the stories would turn out to be. Like, how did a boy's dream of making it in Hollywood in the 1970s lead to a campaign of murders in the 90s?
There was this ping, and there was a bullet flying around the house.
How did a prank gone disastrously wrong influence people to smash their way into the US Capitol on January the 6th?
He walks in, and he's kind of like frantic. I'm like, what's going on, man? And then he's like, I got asked to join the Illuminati.
They're stories about the unexpected instigators of violent culture wars.
We moved to a very nice, wholesome community, and I was just very proud to be living there.
About how innocent lives get destroyed for the most irrational reasons.
I've been convicted of crimes that I not only didn't do, but that never occurred.
About the very first person to be publicly shamed because of something they did online.
Oh, I have to tell the joke. I suppose I do have to tell the joke.
About moments of grace amidst the horror.
I got my miracle. I was blind and now I see. Amazing grace.
Things Fell Apart from BBC Radio 4 is a series of 8 extraordinary stories from the history of the culture wars with me, Jon Ronson. I'm Jon Ronson, a writer living in America, the land where culture wars begin. And by culture wars, I mean almost everything that people yell at each other about on social media.
We want to take masks off our children. That should be our choice.
You are a white privileged male who has no experience.
I can't help what I am. I was born like this.
I'm not saying that people should not be allowed to go through that procedure. What I'm saying is it doesn't make them a woman. It happens to be an opinion.
These wars can obsess us. It can consume our lives and tear families apart. I was curious to learn how things fell apart, and so I went back in history to find the origin stories, the pebbles thrown in the pond, creating the ripples. I had no idea what I would find, but I've uncovered some strange and unexpected tales of real consequence. This story is about the very surprising reason why one of America's first and most violent culture wars began, one that rages to this day.
There was this ping and like a sound of a little shattered glass, and there was a bullet flying around the house. Before the dinger went off on the microwave, Bart was dead.
It'll end with a bullet ricocheting around a kitchen in Buffalo, New York. But it starts with an American boy growing up among Christian intellectuals in a Swiss mountain retreat in the 1960s and 70s, daydreaming about one day directing Hollywood films.
I'm a dyslexic little kid roaming around in the Alps, growing up in a weird fundamentalist American evangelical commune.
The boy's name was Frank Schaefer, and the commune, La Brie, was run by his father, Francis Schaefer, a Christian philosopher and art historian.
He was a completely off-the-wall, wonderful individual, thinning long hair, was wearing a pair of mountain-climbing knickers, of the kind that you associate with Swiss mountaineering back in the day.
He had a goatee, but no moustache, almost like a sort of 60s folk singer type look.
Well, it's kind of seems like an odd juxtaposition, but on Sunday morning he'd be preaching from what he called the inerrant word of God. But on Saturday night, the night before, he might be giving a lecture on Bob Dylan's lyrics.
L'abri, which is the French word for shelter, was a stopover for travellers on their way to ashrams or kibbutzim. This was the early 70s, and Francis, unique among evangelical leaders, would lecture on how Christians should engage with modern art or the Woodstock Festival. He attracted some eclectic fans. Eric Clapton visited, and so did Billy Zioli, the man behind a powerhouse Christian film company, Gospel Films.
People were saying to my father, you ought to really do something that takes the lectures you give on the interrelationship of art, culture, and Christianity on film. You should make a documentary. Billy Zioli put together the financing of about a $3.5 million project, which in those days, that was a lot of money for a documentary.
And you got to direct it, even though you were, what, 19 years old?
Dad was one of these parents who believes in his children's talents.
Frank had grown up in the Alps, idolising directors like Fellini. And while he wasn't especially interested in directing his father's niche Christian art history documentary, he thought maybe he could get a showreel out of it to show Hollywood producers.
At the time, I was looking at this as film school, eventually thinking of going and making what I would have called real movies rather than something for the evangelical market.
Frank embraced the chance to experiment with directorial styles. And the resulting 1976 documentary series, How Should We Then Live, is very ambitious. There are actors in costume and a big travel budget. One minute, Francis is in a Florentine museum.
Anyone who could walk through the museums and not be overwhelmed with the beauty of the work of its art really is a very poor man indeed.
The next, he's on a Paris street, criticising the existentialist Jean-Paul Sartre for his moral relativism.
With Sartre's position, one can equally help an old woman across the street.
Merci, monsieur.
Or run her down.
Well, Dad would use examples like that to try to illustrate the fact that without the word of God, look how bad these guys are. You know, look what this opens the door to.
But this story about a Christian art historian and his ambitious son is about to take a very strange turn. And all because of an unexpected creative decision Frank made midway through production.
Consider the human fetus, the unborn baby. In January 1973, the United States Supreme Court passed the abortion law.
Francis is talking about Roe v. Wade, which protected a woman's right to an abortion in every U.S. state.
By this Supreme Court ruling, the unborn child is considered not to be a person.
The scene is odd, and not only because it was such a drastic gear shift from the rest of the series. It's mostly odd because Christian evangelicals in the 1970s weren't at all engaged with the issue of abortion. This was coming totally from left field.
Most evangelical Christians saw this as a quote-unquote Catholic issue. And in those days, we had nothing to do with Roman Catholics if we could help it. In fact, Dad's theology would say a Roman Catholic is going to hell.
But now, here was the revered Francis Schaeffer in the spirit of fostering his son's creativity, taking up the abortion issue.
It was my suggestion to my dad that we make the last two episodes about abortion and Roe v. Wade and the legalization of abortion. My suggestion came in the context of me being a teenage father myself. It's very personal. It has nothing to do with a philosophical argument. It's like, this was an unwanted pregnancy. Jeannie and I are teenagers. We're having this baby and we love her.
With the 10-part series finished, Frank and his father set about promoting it, with their focus set on conquering the American evangelical market.
We launched the whole thing with a big seminar tour in 16 cities. We had big screens and would show it to audiences of about 15 to 20,000 people in places like Madison Square Gardens.
It was an instant hit with evangelicals. They were packing out stadiums.
We had mass audio cassette copying machines set up, turning out hundreds of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.